Thank you everyone for coming and for the opportunity to talk to you all. The motivation for this talk is to share with you an integrated workflow that we have developed within the Northwest Margin Energy Studies team to apply by understanding the subsurface fluids for the assessment of natural resources. First, I would like to acknowledge geoscience staff across Geoscience Australia with the involvement of many people from different disciplines and different teams. We also had the input and supports from many external colleagues, from marine survey staff, but also from service providers experts, and also we had access to multi-client seismic data. So in this presentation, I will go through an Earth system approach by looking at the groundwater, the energy, and the mineral systems, and to see how they are interconnected by their subsurface fluids. So first, in the introduction, I will cover what are subsurface fluids and why do they matter for resources exploration, and why natural resources are important considering the international context and the national challenges. Then, in a second part, I will illustrate an integrated approach that we have developed and applied to offshore Australian sedimentary basin, and we will look at geological features located for scale in the sedimentary cover. We will go through three main applications using a similar workflow. First, we will go through a dual study looking at two interconnected systems, CO2 and petroleum systems. First, using this integrated workflow to assess the CO2 storage potential in the subsurface geology. And then using this workflow, we will look at assessing the petroleum prospectivity deeper within the Jurassic sequence. Then, in a third application, we will expand this workflow using additional tools to investigate those deeper targets within the Triassic, where the geology is more complex, but also where the data is of poorer quality. And finally, we will look forward how we can apply a similar integrated approach for mineral exploration and groundwater systems assessment. So first, what are subsurface fluids? So fluids can be liquids, they can be gas, they can be cold, they can be hot. They migrate from a source following some migration pathways that have been controlled by the structure of the sedimentary basin. Some of those fluids get trapped underground, and some escape to the surface under the sea or on land. All these fluids are part of different Earth systems, the shallowest one being the groundwater system, where the rain starts to precipitate to recharge some areas, then the water flows down some discharge areas, then the water evaporates and the cycle starts again. This system goes down to several hundred meters. Then we have a deeper system, the hydrocarbon systems, that goes down to several kilometers. I will go into the detail of this system a bit later down the talk. Then we have deeper systems again, the mineral systems that involve hot mineralizing fluids that goes down from several hundred kilometers. They go through the rock and are associated with mineral deposits. And also, we have some systems that reinject the fluids from the top down underground, such as the carbon capture and storage, where you reinject CO2 from power station, the CO2 that has been generated by power station or by large-scale industrial factories, and you reinject the CO2 underground to store it for long term, for millions of years. And this system happens within the same depth range as the hydrocarbon systems. All these systems are interconnected by their subsurface fluids. The fluids migrate from one system to another, and sometimes also they interact. For example, they interact by with hot fluids, the hot mineralizing hot mineralizing fluids, they can interact with hydrocarbons to generate basin-hosted minerals such as lead zinc deposits. So all these fluids are interconnected following some similar migration pathways, and it's by analyzing those migration pathways that we can predict the location of potential new natural resources. And this Earth system approach is supported by the Australian Academy of Science Decadal Plan for Geoscience. So why natural resources are important considering the international context? In our society, we see a growing population with an increase in energy demand and also an increase in energy consumption rising in Asia, Asia being on our doorstep. Energy is the lifeblood of our modern economies that also put some pressure on our growth, on our water usage, but also on the consumption of minerals and critical commodities to support our infrastructure and our sustainable technologies, such as solar panels, batteries, electric cars, etc. So we find ourselves in a global energy dilemma with twin challenges of energy security and climate change. So to make the transition to a lower carbon and still meet energy and resources requirements for the nation, we need to use our resources sustainably. So how can we do this? The best proposed forecast by the International Energy Agency propose that we will be using more gas as an intermediate fuel that releases less CO2 than coal. So we will see a rise in the consumption of gas and a decrease in coal and oil, while we will see a ramping up of the non-fossil fuel energy and with an uptake in renewable development in various forms. And by 2040, the Asia-Pacific region will consume 46% of the world energy. Back in Australia, at home, fossil fuel is still very prominent in our fossil fuel mix, in our energy mix. And we also see a ramping up of the renewable energies that are continuing. The biggest challenges that we see is finding the next source of gas for our domestic market while maintaining supply to the liquefied natural gas plants for export to Japan, China, and other Asian neighbors, and also developing hydrogen as a clean fuel. We also need to mitigate climate change, and we will need assistance from the carbon capture and storage to assist in lowering CO2 emissions, while we will need to improve the management of our groundwater and also continue exploring for mineral and critical commodity to support our technologies. All of this is supported by the National Resources Statement, highlighting that the resource sector is integral to Australia's economy while managing social, safety, and environmental issues. So with this background context, I will now illustrate an integrated approach that we have applied in a dual study looking at two integrated systems, CO2 and petroleum. This study is located on the Northwest Shelf, and you can see on this map of non-renewable energy resources estimate that in gray are highlighted the major energy basins, and those red dots indicate the conventional gas resources. So you can see that the Northwest Shelf hosts Australia's major gas resources offshore. This gas is mainly produced for liquefied natural gas to be exported offshore. Australia is the world's largest exporter of gas, so by doing this, it assists in lowering global emissions, particularly in importing countries that would otherwise generate electricity using coal, and burning coal releases more CO2 than gas. So our study is focused within the Browse Basin that hosts large gas resources, and this gas has started to be produced last year from the Ichthys field, and this year from the Prelude field, the Prelude field being the largest floating LNG of the world. This, the discovery of this gas field are directly linked to a study that has been undertaken in Geoscience Australia during the mid-90s. This study started in 1995 and provided pre-competitive data, but also new acquisition of seismic and interpretation to industry. This resulted in the uptake of vacant acreage release by the Japanese oil company in 1998. So you can see here the lead time between exploration and production, which is over 20 years. Those gas fields are high in natural CO2 content, with an average of 8%. So Geoscience Australia was mandated during 2013 and 2016 to undertake a regional assessment for geological storage potential in this basin. This study was part of the National CO2 Infrastructure Plan that was designed to accelerate the identification of suitable areas for CO2 storage that are close to major emission sources. So before going deeper in this study, we will start with some basic concepts, understanding a petroleum system. So a petroleum system starts with a source rock that is rich in organic matter. This source rock needs to be buried deep enough to reach some temperature and pressure to be sufficient to convert the organic matter into hydrocarbons. Then those hydrocarbons migrate out of the source rock to migrate towards a reservoir that is porous and permeable enough for the fluids to go through the grains, such as sandstone. And this reservoir needs to be associated with a good cap rock that is permeable to avoid the fluid to escape, such as a shale or a mudstone. Then, the oil and gas focus its migration within a structural and stratigraphic trap to form an accumulation. In our dual system, we also need to investigate some good reservoirs that are away from prospective area for hydrocarbon to store our CO2 for long term. So to find those reservoirs, to avoid resource conflicts, we also need to identify regional limiting factors for CO2 containment, the first one being finding suitable reservoir within a depth range where you can store economically the CO2 in its supercritical form, which is below 800 meters where the CO2 is in a fluid phase. And those reservoirs also need to be above 3,000 meters deep to be economical and for a technical reason as well. The second factor you need a good cap rock that extends laterally enough over your area to avoid the CO2 to escape. Then the third criteria, you need to investigate the integrity of your seal that could have been compromised by fault reactivation, breaching the seal and producing some conduits for fluid migrations towards the seafloor. So once you have all these criteria gathered, and you are away from conflicts with hydrocarbon resources, you can reinject your CO2 in some reservoirs for long-term storage for millions of years. In some basins around the world, CO2 injection is also used to reinject in hydrocarbon reservoirs to enhance oil recovery for production efficiency, but this is not the scenario that we are looking at for this study. So in our study, we are looking at this dual system where we are looking at reservoir for CO2 storage potential in the shallow subsurface and reservoir for petroleum prospectivity in the deeper geology within the Jurassic. So in this example, we also need to minimize resource conflict. So we need to know that the hydrocarbon targets for exploration are mostly focused within the Jurassic and Lower Cretaceous. So we focused on finding good reservoirs for CO2 storage within the Cretaceous, the Cretaceous interval being in the optimal storage depth window for CO2 storage. So with this understanding and using this dual approach, we need to first understand the basin as a whole. So to do this, we used a multidisciplinary workflow that can be applied both for CO2 storage assessment, but also for petroleum prospectivity. So we started by gathering all our data from wells, seismic, potential field, bathymetry, multi-beam bathymetry, palynology, geochemistry, etc. And we correlate all our data using macrofossils that can help correlate them in a stratigraphic framework. Using this correlation, we can then build the structure of the basin in 3D and understand the evolution of the sediment packages through time. Then we interpret the depositional environments to produce some paleogeographic and play fairway maps. And then we integrate with the geochemical data from the down the wells to characterize the source rocks and understand how they relate to the fluids within the known accumulations. Finally, we combine all this data and interpretation within a 3D geological model to predict where hydrocarbons may have been generated and where those fluids may have been migrating. So this same workflow has been applied for two different purposes. So we started by updating all our well data with the well logs, lithology, palynology, geochemistry, etc. And we can correlate all this data using biostratigraphy that use microfossils to establish relative ages between the rocks when they are buried at a certain depth. And this allows us to correlate the sedimentary packages within the basin, but also across basins. So this is a critical link for data integration. With this understanding, we can then correlate the ages and lithologies with basin tectonic phases that allows us to correlate regional geological events across the basin, such as this. And we've been able also to use a common Northwest Shelf nomenclature that has been adopted by industry and also is aligned with the international geological timescale. So this allows us to correlate regional geological events in a global understanding. Using this common stratigraphic language benefits all explorers working in this area. During our study, we have looked in more detail at the geological packages within the Jurassic and the Cretaceous using this common nomenclature. So this allows to build well-to-well correlations, so you can integrate all your wells with the well log, lithology, etc., across the basins. That allows you to correlate those regional events representing similar timeline, so we are working in a sequence stratigraphy. This helps us to define the geometry of your sediment packages, the thickness across the basin, but also it helps us to identify the distribution, the lateral distribution of the lithology within the different packages. Then we tie the well to the seismic data to interpolate the subsurface geology between the wells. So what is seismic data? Seismic data, it's like an echography of the subsurface using the reflection of sound waves to image the structure of the deeper geological layers. So using this image and using the information from the wells, we can correlate those regional geological events correlating to similar times in the wells. So here we have interpreted the main packages within the Cretaceous and the overburden. Using this similar approach, we have also interpreted all these sedimentary packages from the top Permian to the water bottom. This allows us to show the evolution of your sedimentary packages through time. So for example, here we have the sediment thickness within the deposited during this period, the Permo-Carboniferous. In blue are highlighted the six sediments, and you can see through time, we have also mapped the sediment thickness within the Triassic, the Jurassic, the Cretaceous, and the Cenozoic. So this shows you the evolution of the accommodation space through time, and also the evolution of your sediment film. Then, what we do, we also interpret the deep positional models for every interval. So for example, for this interval in the K30 within the lower Cretaceous, using the well information and the lateral variation on the seismic, we can interpret in yellow some sand-rich sediments that have been deposited on an inner shelf. In green, we have interpreted mud and minor sands deposited on an outer shelf, and some mud and marls deposited on a slope and basin floor. Below here is a zoom of this proposed model for the K30 interval, showing in yellow the deposition of the good reservoirs that extend across the basin, with also some submarine fans that are overlain by thick mudstones that are potentially some good silts. So using this information with all the key wells and seismic across the basin, we can map on a plan view the paleogeography for this interval, for example. That also helps us to highlight the distribution of the reservoirs that are lighted in yellow and orange, and the overlying seals that are lighted in brown and green. And we have done this for every interval within the Cretaceous to help us identify reservoirs for potential CO2 storage in this basin. So this integrated workflow also helped us to identify those major regional limiting factors for CO2, which are first, the identification of suitable reservoir depth window within the basin for each layer. So here, we have mapped the base of every interval within the Cretaceous, and this green interval highlights the suitable depths for CO2 storage for each interval. Then we had to map the extent of the seals for each interval. For example, for the K30, we have mapped the extent of the top seals that extend across all the basin. Then the other criteria is to assess the integrity of the seal that may have been compromised by the shallow fault, such as the shallow fault that connect the reservoir at depth to the surface. These faults have been mapped and show the distribution here in this blue envelope right across the basin. Some of these faults have a trend directly parallel to the current stress field, putting them in a high risk of reactivation. So to test whether this resin faulting is associated with seafloor seepage, we have undertaken two marine surveys, the first one in 2013 and the second one in 2014. The result of those surveys didn't observe any active seepage, but they have been able to map in great detail those seafloor faults that you can see at the top on the sub-bottom profiler data. They are associated with those great features on the multi-beam bathymetry data. These images have been acquired using an autonomous underwater vehicle and a remotely operated vehicle. During those surveys, we have been also able to gather some baseline environmental information that are useful for every parties working in this area. So now, gathering all this information by overlapping those different criteria, we can eliminate areas with high level of containment constraint for each packages. And for example, for this K30, we have highlighted here the extent of the suitable reservoir depths for CO2 storage in green. We have also mapped the extent of the seal. We have mapped also the location of the intense faulting within this interval and the location of hydrocarbon occurrences in this interval. So by overlapping all these criteria, we can then highlight in green the most suitable areas for potential CO2 storage within this interval. So we've done this for every interval within the Cretaceous that highlight that the lower Cretaceous is potentially more prospective for CO2 storage than the upper Cretaceous. So using this integrated approach, here we've been able to look at this concept of potential CO2 storage in the basin. Now, using this similar approach, we are investigating petroleum prospectivity in the deeper succession within the Jurassic. So to do this, we have gathered all the mapping we've done previously in a 3D geological model. So we've gathered all this mapping to map the geology through time. So at the beginning, we had the seafloor at the current time, and going back in time, we see the seafloor morphology down to the top Permian. All those different colors indicate the geometry of the different packages related at different times. So putting all this information in a 3D model helps us to better understand the burial and temperature history evolution across the basin. So then we identified the main source rock across the basin by using the geochemical data collected, sampled during down the wells. So for example, here in orange, we have highlighted a good source rocks that correlate with some good mudstone and some coals, and they are associated with some high TOC numbers. TOC is for total organic content, and you can see that this content is good to excellent. Then using this information across the various wells in the basin and using seismic data, we can map the extent of those source rocks with their characteristics. So we have mapped here the early to middle Jurassic source rocks, but also the late Jurassic source rocks and within the lower Cretaceous. So then we need to understand if those source rocks have been buried enough, have been cooked enough to generate enough any hydrocarbon across the basin. So to do this, we have combined the geological model with some geochemical parameters to estimate the proportion of source rocks that has been converted into hydrocarbon. And for example, we have modeled the main source rock in the basin that has generated most of the gas in the basin. So you can see that this source rock started to expel hydrocarbon locally during the late Jurassic, followed by the main phase of expulsion during the late Cretaceous, until all the basin, and most of the basin, has expelled hydrocarbon. So with this information, we can then estimate the amount of oil and gas that has been generated from this source rock across the basin, and we've done this for every source rocks, the main source rocks in the basin. So now this is a model, so we need to ground truth the model using fluid properties from the geochemical samples down the wells in the known accumulations. So to do this, we have superimposed the modeled expert hydrocarbons with the known hydrocarbon related to these source rocks that are highlighted in orange. And using the geometry of the geological model, we can deduce the migration pathways from the source rock within the depot center toward the reservoirs. This then helps us to redefine the extent of the proven extent of the petroleum system and propose the extent of the system using the model. And we've done this as well for the other source rocks in the basin. So now by combining our mapping with the model, we can overlay here in yellow, we have identified some potential reservoirs within this interval that overlays some modeled expelled hydrocarbon generated from the underlying source rocks. This helps us to identify some potential areas that are prospective for hydrocarbons, such as in those areas in pink. And those areas are located within exploration permits that were vacant during these studies. So a testament to the impact of this work is the uptake of those vacant acreage after this study. So we've done, after this study, promotional work, going to different conferences within Australia, but also in Singapore at CPEX, and also during the Asia tour, that resulted in the uptake of this large permit onshore the Browse Basin by INPEX, this major Japanese oil company that is now producing the Ichthys field. The following year, industry used directly our work to farm in during the PISA deal day, and it resulted in the uptake of those northern permits by Carnarvon Petroleum and Shell. So you can see here, by using this integrated approach, we've been able to assess petroleum prospectivity, but also we've been able to influence the uptake of acreage permits that were previously thought being unprospective in these underexplored areas. Now moving on to a third application, we are expanding this workflow by adding some additional tools to image those deeper targets within the Triassic. Within the Triassic, it was noted that a poor understanding of the source rock, of the nature and the distribution of the source rock, was a critical exploration uncertainty, particularly south of the Browse Basin in the central Northwest Shelf. So Geoscience Australia undertook a regional mapping exercise within the Triassic, using 2D, but also most of the 3D seismic data available in this area. And during this study, some discoveries were made, and particularly the largest discovery in Australia for decades that regenerated a considerable interest in the Triassic petroleum system, but it also regenerated the acquisition of deep seismic data to image those deeper targets in the basin. So Geoscience Australia got access to the largest 3D surveys ever acquired offshore Australia, and this image shows you the size of this data set that corresponds to more than 650 terabytes. This survey corresponds to more than 22,000 square kilometers, and it's highlighted within this white outline, located right in the middle of our study area. So to interpret such large data, we used a trial of a semi-automatic approach, first to help us with the geological reconnaissance through the data set, but also help us with the interpretation efficiency. Then we've used the information from those new wells that have penetrated the Triassic with other wells across the basin to constrain our seismic interpretation. And this helped us to redefine the geometry of the depot center through the Triassic. So on those thickness maps, the blue area shows you where the sediments are thick. So you can see that during the early to middle Triassic, the sedimentation started within two depot centers and evolved progressively, mostly depositing within one depot center. This interpretation also helped us to refine the lateral distribution of the lithology within the Triassic, where we have highlighted here an intratectonic basin that has been formed with a narrow seaway with Murrayed Mudstone highlighted in green. In yellow are highlighted fluodeltaic sediments, and progressively this intratectonic basin evolved with a shallow marine environment with carbonate interbedded with siliciclastic shown in blue. You can see also in red that we have interpreted a volcanic province that has been penetrated by two wells and reached some basalt. However, the nature of the sedimentary package below within the early to middle Triassic remains uncertain. So industry proposed two alternative scenarios, and on this seismic line located here, you can see that this sedimentary package in orange has been proposed to be either as a series of carbonate ramps or as a lava delta complex. So this difference in interpretation is significant for the petroleum prospectivity of the area. So to test those two scenarios, We combined a gravity and magnetic model to compute the gravity and magnetic response of those two geological scenarios. So the result of the models shows that this seismic package correlates with high density but also high magnetic bodies, indicating that they are most likely of volcanic origin. So this is in accordance with our seismic interpretation. However, it downgrades the petroleum prospectivity in this red area offshore, but mostly within the lower package in the early Cretaceous. In fact, in the overlaying sequences, we have identified good source rocks with local good to excellent potential. So this whole area is not completely downgraded, just the lower part of the Triassic. So through this example, we have expanded the workflow using other tools to assess those deeper reservoirs for petroleum prospectivity. So now I will look forward how we can use a similar integrated approach for mineral exploration and groundwater system assessment. So to do this, we have started by integrating all our data in one common 3D model. This allows us first to interpret in real time in a 3D space, but it also enables us to share ideas across disciplines and looking at different depths for different purposes. This allows us as well to store all our data in one common repository, where we can then export all this data in a simple format for everyone to access. So for example, here on the Northwest Shelf, we have started to capture all the multi-beam bathymetry from those marine surveys. And in the Browse Basin, we have also integrated with all the well data, all the well logs and geochemical data, etc. We have also integrated with the seismic data and with the seismic interpretation through time, so from the Cenozoic, the Cretaceous, Jurassic, Triassic. And from the Browse Basin, we have expanded this interpretation south through the Roebuck and Northern Carnarvon to produce those regional maps across most of the Northwest Shelf. With this information, we then integrated with gravity and magnetic data to provide a regional context that enables us to link the offshore with the onshore geology. So this integrated approach for data integration is possible as well onshore, and we can add other data sets, such as airborne electromagnetic data that are used for groundwater and mineral exploration. So using an integrated approach, you can see that we can assess different systems by putting all this information in a common 3D geological model with a common structure and stratigraphic framework that enables us to investigate the subsurface marine migration pathways to look at different depths at different purposes. So for example, onshore, if we integrate with this other data set, the airborne electromagnetic data, this data set detects variation in conductivity of the ground down to several hundred meters. So this provides a very important link between the surface geology and the seismic data at depth. And this information helps to understand the structure and the fluid migration pathways through the different system, and also help us to assess the potential for mineral and groundwater resources. So as a first step, Cameron Mitchell has started to integrate within a seismic interpreting package the airborne electromagnetic data, highlighting here, with some seismic data, but also with some seismic interpretation, with some borehole data, with the surface geology, and also the sea-based data underneath. So you can integrate with any kind of data you want, but this helps you to map. So integrating the shallow with the deep geology helps you to map this 3D geology that enables you then to investigate your migration pathways for different purposes. And in this case, it can help you to assess groundwater and mineral systems. So in conclusion, by adopting a system thinking approach, you can answer different questions at different depths. And to do this, you need first to integrate all your data, but you also need to interpret your data in a global understanding using a common structure and stratigraphic framework that is necessary to understand all your systems for mineral, energy, and groundwater systems. You also need to ground truth all your geophysical studies with field studies, and you need to move from descriptive to predictive approach to be able to predict your fluid migration pathways, for example. And all of this is possible if you combine all your data and information into one 3D geological model. So when you do all these things, then it's possible to have the impact for petroleum prospectivity and to prove the concept for CO2 storage in the basin. We also propose that we can use a similar approach for other questions such as mineral exploration and groundwater systems. This integration can be done in other packages than this one, but looking at all this data in one place, we find will be very useful for everyone to have a win-win situation. So if you want to access all those data and outputs, they are available on our GA web pages, and the geochemical data are available through the GA portal. Thanks for Diane and all the developers' efforts that they have put in this web portal. And finally, I would like to say that all this work wouldn't have been possible individually, so I really would like to thank the whole team for their effort and hard work that has made this possible. So thank you very much.